Stories you've heard that have David in them, and we even talked about him a little last week. David killed Goliath when he was a young man and was anointed by Samuel to be the future king of Israel. He also spent quite a bit of time running around in the desert trying not to get killed by the current king of Israel. Thank you.
son of Jesse, why didn't you kill me?
Because the Lord made you my king.
Oh, thanks. And do you know what happened to my socks?
He eventually got the throne. Then, because David was a man, he sinned. He lusted after Bathsheba, one of his soldiers' wives. And then he committed adultery because of that lust. And then, to cover up the lust and the adultery, he murdered Uriah, the husband of Bathsheba. But despite all of these shortcomings, he's called a man after God's own heart, which is kind of encouraging because he really messed up quite a few times and God still loved him, which means that even when you and I mess up really bad, God still loves us. There is a difference between Saul, who was the first king of Israel, and David, who was the second king of Israel and the king that God actually wanted. Why was David called a man after God's own heart and promised a dynasty and a kingdom, and Saul wasn't? It's pretty simple. It came down to what they did when they messed up, because they both messed up a lot. When Saul messed up, he didn't listen to God. He just kind of ignored the problem in hopes that it would solve itself. And when it got worse, he made up excuses. For example, there was this one town and they weren't supposed to take any of the riches or the animals for themselves, but Saul got greedy. And so he took whatever he wanted. When the prophet heard all of the animals making animal noises, Saul was all like, yo, bruh, why on God's green earth do I hear a bunch of animals making animal noises? And Saul was all like, yeah, so, well, you see, Teach. So I got these animals to sacrifice for God. Yeah, that's what I was doing. That's why I did it. But of course, God didn't like that Saul was disobeying, no matter what stories he made up. On the other hand, when David messed up, he acknowledged that he had messed up. For example, another prophet came up to David after he had killed the husband of Bathsheba. Oh, king, I got a question for your smart ship.
Does everybody in old times rap or something? They do.
And David's like, shoot, my guy, what's up? And then the prophet's like, so hypothetically, what should we do if there's these two guys in this town, right? And one's like super ultra rich, like Elon Musk rich, with a million sheep. And then the other dude is like super poor and he only had one sheep to his name. And Elon Musk had some friends over for dinner and he stole the poor dude's only sheep and served it for dinner. What should we do? Hypothetically, that is. And David was really mad. And so he goes, oh, you know what we should do? He deserves to die. And he has to make up for what he stole four times over. And then the prophet looks at David and he goes, you are that man. And David immediately realized what the prophet was talking about. And he felt horrible because he knew that he really messed up. But instead of having the prophet killed or something, he tore his clothes and covered himself in ashes.
Sounds like a good way to deal with things.
Because that's the way that they mourned or grieved in that culture. He cried out to God and begged for forgiveness. He also admitted what he had done wrong. And because this is the way David handled his sin, he is called a man after God's own heart. But there's something else that's different about David and Saul. See, the Israelites really wanted a king, but God told them it was a bad idea. In typical human form, they didn't listen to God. So they picked the biggest, strongest, handsomest man they could find, Saul. And we all know how that ended. So sword drill, 1 Samuel 16:7, go. So when Saul was messing up, God told the prophet to go find the new king. And the prophet's like, how am I gonna know who it is? And so in verse 7, but the Lord said to Samuel, do not look at his appearance or at his physical stature, because I have refused him. For the Lord does not see as man sees. For a man looks at the outward appearance, but the Lord looks at the heart. Keep your finger there. When God picked David, he wasn't looking for the most handsome or tall or strong or outgoing man he could find. He was looking for someone whose heart aligned with his own. Now, I don't know if you remember the story of David's anointing. So let's read a section of it real quick, right after that verse, starting in verse 8. So 1 Samuel 16:8 through 11. So Jesse called Abinadab and made him pass before Samuel. And he said, neither has the Lord chosen this one. Then Jesse made Shammah pass by, and he said, neither has the Lord chosen this one. Thus Jesse made seven of his sons pass before Samuel. And Samuel said to Jesse, the Lord has not chosen these. And Samuel said to Jesse, are all the young men here? Then he said, there remains yet the youngest, and there he is keeping the sheep. And Samuel said to Jesse, send and bring him, for we will not sit down till he comes here. Did you catch it? Jesse didn't bring David in from the fields to pass by Samuel. Why? Maybe because Jesse didn't think David was good enough to be the new king of Israel. Or maybe Jesse just plain old forgot about him. David was probably a pretty quiet, introverted kid. He spent most of his time watching the sheep and playing his harp. He was also the youngest. And if any of you are part of a big family, you've probably seen or even experienced. A sibling getting forgotten in the craziness that is life. Who else was forgotten in the Bible? Sword drill. Luke 2, 41-46. Go. His parents went to Jerusalem every year at the Feast of Passover, and when he was 12 years old, they went up to Jerusalem, according to the custom of the feast. When they had finished the days, as they returned, the boy Jesus lingered behind in Jerusalem, and Joseph and his mother did not know it. But supposing him to have been in the company, they went a day's journey and sought him among their relatives and acquaintances. So, when they did not find him, they returned to Jerusalem seeking him. Now so, it was that after 3 days, they found him in the temple, sitting in the midst of the teachers, both listening to them and asking them questions. Did you catch that one? Mary and Joseph forgot about Jesus. And it took them a whole day to realize they forgot him, and then 3 days to find him. Also, Mary and Joseph knew that Jesus was the Son of God, so they forgot the Son of God. Mary and Joseph were entrusted to take care of him and to raise the Son of God. So what do you think Jesus was like in middle school? Because that's when his parents forgot him. That's also when David's parents forgot about him. So what do you think Jesus was like? Do you think y'all would have been friends? We have some clues to what he was like. So first, Jesus wasn't a troublemaker and an attention seeker. It was also likely that he was kind of bookish and quiet. Because first, his parents didn't realize that he wasn't with them. So it wasn't like he was super loud and larger than life, even though he literally is larger than life. And second, they found him at the temple, reading God's word. So I'll ask it again. Would you have been friends with middle school Jesus? Are you like middle school Jesus now? And are you friends with Jesus now? All interesting questions that we may not have the answers for right now. And that's okay, it's just something to think about. If God looks at the heart, and not the outward appearance. And even Jesus wasn't tall, dark, and handsome. What should that tell you about us today? In our culture, just like in every other culture, appearance is everything. And appearance can mean a lot of things, like clothing, hair, accessories, what you listen to, what you read, what gadgets or games you have, what car your parents drive, what kind of house or apartment you live in, if or what you post on social media, what vacations you go on. The list is endless. And it can be exhausting to stay on top of the trends and to make sure our outward appearance and our outward personality is carefully crafted to make us the most friends or have the biggest social media following. But throughout the Bible, this is not the example we see. And it's not like, oh, you have to sell everything you own and go live in a cardboard box on Tejon. That won't make you happy. And it won't give you success, probably. What will make you happy and what will give you success is clearly illustrated in the Bible. Be yourself and have a heart after God's. Follow God and run as fast as you can towards him, all the while being as loud or as quiet or as tall or as short as you are right now. God loves using ordinary people who love him. So our focus should be on loving God and loving his people. The rest will work out. And of course you can wear those cool shoes or get those AirPods or whatever you're into, but it cannot take the place of God. It will not fill that God-shaped hole in your heart. And you will continue to feel empty no matter how much time or money you spend on trying to fill it. Only God can satisfy. David was rich, he had a lot of money, he had a lot of popularity, lots of gadgets, a lot of everything really. But what made him happy wasn't his stuff, it was God. Let's pray. Thank you for allowing us to study your word together today. I pray that you help us look at ourselves through your eyes and to look at others through your eyes. Thank you for blessing us with all the gadgets and gizmos that we have today, but help us not get distracted by those things and by our image, but instead focus on you. God, you have shown us that we can be super cool like David and Jesus if we walk with you. So help us do that this week. Amen. I love y'all, and I'll catch you next time. Hey guys, before you go to small groups, I need your help with a future lesson. So I need your guys' testimonies, and your testimony has 3 parts. First, what your life was like before you met God. Second, how did you meet God? And third, how did your life change after God? So just polo me answering those 3 questions. You'll have a chance to be on video. If you get it to me by the end of the month, which is by next Sunday, then you'll get a big giant candy bar. Bye.